Okay, welcome. This is our first workshop of workshop week, handing it over to Sarah Mirk. Thank you so much for being here and leading this for us. And yeah, thank you all for being here.
Well, hi everyone. I think our most distant person so far is the artist from Chile, Natalia. So I think you win the award for longest distance to this workshop. But thanks to everyone for coming from wherever it is you are. And feel free to say hi in the chat. Thanks for coming, Natalia and everybody else. So this workshop is an hour long. I'm gonna do a presentation about the comics journalism that I do and kind of like some basics about my work and how creating nonfiction comics works. And then we are each gonna draw a little comic based on our own lives for the last half an hour of the workshop. So if you are like terrified of writing and drawing and don't wanna do it, then you can skip out on the last half an hour, but I would recommend you take this as an opportunity to deal with some of that anxiety and put pen to paper. So I'm gonna get started. I'm gonna share my screen and show you my little presentation. And while we're all drawing at the end, I'll take questions. So if you have any questions, think of them now, feel free to drop them in the chat and I'll see them after I do my presentation, or you can just hold on to them and speak them aloud at the end. Sound okay? Great. Okay, cool. Just give me a thumbs up if you can see this. Yay? Okay, cool. So this is who I am. I live here in Portland, Oregon. I make comics in a whole bunch of different formats. I've actually made comics my whole life. I grew up reading comics and started drawing them, you know, like at the kitchen table. And then when I was a teenager, I made comics about my own life and was kind of like made like angsty zine, teen zines, which, and thought I was basically the only person in the world doing that until I went to like a big comics festival and realized there was a wide world of people making zines and people making comics and people telling stories about their lives, other people's lives through illustration. And I just loved that. So for about 10 years, I worked as like a more traditional journalist for newspapers and magazines and I hosted a podcast. And at the whole time I was kind of making comics on the side. And then in 2017, I started working for an outlet called The Nib and making comics more professionally and sort of mixing those worlds of comics and journalism together. One series we did for The Nib and with Reveal, where I also work, is called Invulnerable. We made comics about the pandemic. And so I'm just gonna talk a little bit about the process of making comics, because oftentimes when I tell people, oh, I'm a comics journalist, they have no idea what that means at all. So you can be a person who just writes comics. You can be someone who just edits comics. So you take what somebody else has written and you get it into being a final draft. You can be somebody who draws comics and you can be a person who pencils, inks, colors, or letters. You can be a publisher. Comics that I write, edit, draw, and then publish. And sometimes I work collaboratively with people to do all of those different things. And so that's just kind of cool to know, is like, if you don't like drawing, you can think about writing a comic and collaborating with someone as an artist. If you love to draw, but you're like not sure how to go about writing, maybe you're somebody who should collaborate with a writer. To make comics, you really don't need anything fancy at all. I feel like that can kind of be impediment to starting to make comics, is thinking like, oh, I have to like buy an iPad or I have to buy like an expensive tablet. I mostly make comics with one sheet of paper that I fold into being a little zine and a pen and pencil. So for the comics journalism that I do, I use pen and paper, and then I use my phone to take reference photos. And then I do lots of research online, like on Wikipedia. So you don't need anything fancy. If you do want to like do something digitally, I recommend an iPad and a program called Procreate. Okay, so there's a bunch of different types of nonfiction comics. You can do memoir comics, which are stories about your own life. So both of these comics that you see on the screen here are about my own experiences. The one on the left is about getting tested for COVID-19. This was back in the spring. So there was all kinds of like misconceptions about how this process worked. And I just wanted to go get tested and then make a little comic about here's how it works. On the right is a comic about white privilege and like my own thinking about my race and privilege and power in my life. Another type of nonfiction comic that I work on is interview comics. So in this example here on the screen, I got to talk to the cat behaviorist, Jackson Galaxy for the Nib magazine. And so I interviewed Jackson Galaxy over the phone. I got a transcript of that interview and then I edited that down into a script that then was drawn by an artist. In this case, it's Gerardo Alba. And that was published. So that's a really cool way to incorporate comics without having to do like a ton of research or like spending a year doing work. Just talk to somebody and turn it into a comic. Here's some other great panels from that comic. So as you can see here, the text in the narration boxes at the top is all quotes from Jackson Galaxy. And together it tells a story. Aren't these cats cool? I love these cats. As you can see here, the illustrations add a lot to the text. Another type of comic that you can work on is what I call a reported comic. So this is where you go out and do research based on reading books, reading articles, watching videos, listening to podcasts, and then taking all that research and making it into like a short story that you're illustrating. So in the one scene here, it's about voting by mail. So I did a bunch of research about how to vote by mail and the kind of like statistics around how voting by mail is super safe and not fraudulent. And I made that into this little comic. So here's what the first pages look like. This was right before the 2020 election. There was a ton of like misinformation about voting by mail. President Trump and a lot of other Republicans were saying that it was not safe, that it was fraudulent, that it would never work, that the system would break down. And here in Oregon, where I live, we voted by mail for like 20 years. So I wanted to make this comic about my experiences voting by mail and doing some reporting about that and how that works nationwide. You can still see a couple of my pencil marks on this page. As you can see, this was written and drawn by hand. So I wrote it in pencil first. Then I went back and did it again in pen. And then I went back and erased my pencil. But as you can see, I missed a little bit of my pencil there. And I think that the value this adds is just making this information a lot more accessible and easy to read. So not everyone would go out and like read a book about how vote by mail works, but I'm happy to go do that research and then make it a lot more digestible. So engaging, easy to read, easy to understand. That's one thing that I think that comics have the real power to do is to make information really accessible and to make it relevant. You know, that a lot of people will read a zine or read a comic that won't go out and read a big dense history book. So if that's not the way you get your information, that's okay. I think as journalists, our job is to make that information easy for people to understand and read and make it feel like it's relevant to their lives. So you can also do a reported comic that's based not just on reading other people's work, but on reading other people's work and interviewing people. So for this comic that I did at the beginning of the pandemic, I did some research with secondary sources, which means reading articles, listening to podcasts, watching videos, reading books, and then also primary sources of interviewing people. So talking to grocery workers in this case about what they're experiencing on the job. I pitched this comic to NPR because I was just curious about what grocery workers were experiencing during the pandemic. As I was going to the grocery store, I was like, what's it like working here? Like, is it bad? Is it okay? Do they feel safe? Do they feel unsafe? I'm not sure what people are feeling as I'm going to the grocery store. And it's like not really appropriate to stop and ask somebody at their job, like, hey, how's it going? You feel safe? Like, that's not a good situation for them. So I made a little online survey and had grocery workers fill it out. And I got like, I think like 50 responses. And then I could combine those interviews that I did with the survey and combine that with the secondary research that I did and make this comic about their experiences. And I just made that survey that grocery workers filled out through Google Forms, which is free, super easy to use. Here's a couple more panels. So you can see here, I drew the grocery workers looking anonymous. So they're just like, basically like elaborate stick figures because everyone who I talked to was really nervous about getting fired. So instead of making them look anything like how they actually look, I went with the sort of like generic human form here that's clearly not like representing someone accurately. It's just sort of standing in for like, here's a grocery worker. So other times when I'm drawing, I'll really try and match someone's like skin tone, hair tone, and put them in clothing that they would wear. But here, because it's anonymous and I wanted to be clear that it's anonymous, I made them more like generic stick figure-like figures. If you're interested in comics journalism, here's a bunch of other books. Feel free to screenshot this page. These are some of my favorite nonfiction books that are built around really great reporting and storytelling. So there's like a really rich history and present of comics journalism. Here's a book that I made called Guantanamo Voices. And I'm gonna talk you through a couple pages from the book and how they were made to show how I put this book together. So this book, it's about Guantanamo Prison, which is an American prison that's on a military base that we built in Cuba. And I got interested in Guantanamo about in 2008 when I met a veteran who had worked there. And hearing their stories about their experiences working there made me be like, oh my God, this is a real place full of real people. And from there, I talked to people who had been imprisoned there, a lot of lawyers who had worked with people who were in prison there, just people all across the board that were related to Guantanamo. And this book is a collection of 10 interviews. Each one is illustrated by a different artist. So each chapter has its own like voice as well as its own visual voice. So one of the first things that I did was actually get to go to Guantanamo. So this was important both for my experiences and understanding and writing the book, but also so that I could take photo references that artists could use in the actual book. So I signed up to go on a media tour of the prison. I had to get a background check through the military, and then I was able to go there in April 2019. And here's how my process worked for the book. Is first I did a bunch of research. Then I actually wrote like the script for the book, which I'll show you some examples of. And that script is edited and fact-checked and usually goes through like a couple different drafts. In this case, the script for this book went through like 3 drafts. And then you actually draw based on that script and then it's published. So that's what the process looks like. And I'm gonna show you an example of some comics I drew over the summer from like reference photos I took to what the panels looked like in the final comic. So one thing that's special about comics is that they can help keep people anonymous. When you're going to protests, for example, or other places where people might not want to have their face, like, you know, put up on the internet forever, is you can take photos and then turn those into comics panels that are more anonymous. So I took this photo at a Black Lives Matter protest over the summer. And then I made a little comic about my experience going to the protest. So here's what the original photo looks like. I put it onto my iPad and actually just like traced over some of the bodies and some of the signs. So some things that I try and keep and not change when I'm drawing a comic are any text that shows up. So like if someone's holding a sign, I don't like make up different signs than what I saw in the crowd. So it might be like that, you know, the person in the middle is not holding the sign that the person was actually holding in the middle of that photo, but it's like a sign that was at that protest. I also wouldn't add anything like weapons, for example, I would not add, but I would take some things away. So in this case, I took away the background and I took away a lot of the people in the crowd to keep this up as a more focused image where you can really like kind of see the signs and it's less messy. Then I added this background color. I liked this color because it felt like it had some like emotional weight to it, but wasn't overwhelming. And then I added the text. So this is my narration. This is just my thoughts on the protest. So here's what that original reference photo looks like versus the final panel. And you can really see the choices I made in transferring this from real life into the comic. The thing about comics is it's not like photojournalism. It's not just taking a photo and then printing that in the paper. There is like a lot of subjectivity that goes into it. There's a lot of your own creative choices that you make going into it and the way that you decide to tell the story visually. Here's another example. So this is somebody who was watching the protest as it was going by. I just was really interested in this person's like body language, and it just seemed like a stark, really strong visual moment to me of like, you know, somebody who's clearly working at a restaurant from what they're wearing, like a restaurant worker watching this protest go by. And then I liked the graffiti on the boarded up windows, because it's like so much of this moment is like seeing all these boarded up windows around. So here's the final panel. And here's what the reference photo looks like again. So you can clearly see some of the choices I made there. But something that does look the same, for example, is like what they're wearing. I was interested in this person, you know, clearly representing that like they're a restaurant worker. And you can tell that from the apron that they're wearing, all black, having that towel, to me says, oh, this person's clearly a restaurant worker. So I wouldn't like put them in a different uniform, but you can see some other choices that I made here. Like I took the shadows out of the sidewalk. I made the graffiti much more readable than it is in real life. And I changed some of the colors around. Okay, here's one more photo from that protest. This is everyone like lay down on the Burnside Bridge as like a kind of replicating the experience of George Floyd being held down. And people waited, I think, for 9 minutes during this time. So this was a really, really powerful, powerful moment to be part of. And I wanted to capture this in the comic. So I took that photo, I redrew it here, and then I added this guy, and then my own thoughts as the text. So you can see the changes that happened from the beginning to the end. So I definitely made some choices here. Like I took out the car in the middle of the crowd because I just thought it broke up the symmetry of the crowd. I wanted your focus to be on, oh, all these people are laying here, not what's that car doing there? Is somebody driving across the bridge? Like, is that person like driving through this crowd? What's happening there? It just was visually confusing. So I just took it out. And then of course I changed the colors of the sky. So this happened like around sunset, but it wasn't like obviously as like orange and vivid as it is in this shot. So those are some of the choices that you can make as a comics artist when you're dealing with like telling a nonfiction story, but you're still making creative choices in there. I always like to keep in mind these questions when I'm working on a comic, like making it very clear who's talking, what you're saying, like what's your narration, and then how can you portray a situation accurately when you're being creative? So in those examples that I just showed you, hopefully it was very clear to you that all the text on the screen was my narration, that's me talking. That's not like I didn't do a speech bubble indicating that was somebody in the frame speaking, but it's my thoughts. And then you can see that there's some things that I kept really accurate and some things that I changed. And I think every comics artist would debate like what those elements are. I'm not gonna read this whole panel because it's a lot, but you can see like what do comics journalists base on real life? I really try and be very, very accurate about the facts of different events, quotes that people say. So making sure I'm quoting them with what they actually said. The way people look in terms of trying to match their skin tone, hair, body size, that kind of thing, their uniforms if they're wearing them. And then the setting. So try to get like the street scenes in there. I try to make the setting very, very accurate, as well as signage. So I don't like make up protest signs, for example. But I do make some changes. So I change backgrounds, I change colors, and I change some small details. And just like every other journalistic medium, all interviews are edited and abridged to choose quotes. So basically any interview you read in any publication will be abridged and edited in some way. Comics is just the same, except you're probably cutting it down a lot more just to get a few quotes that work for your very brief story. Good and bad thing about comics is they've got to be brief. Here's a comic I did for The Nib and with my collaborator, Ilari Harris, and it's illustrated by Joyce Rice. So this is another comic about the pandemic. We did it, it's about the flu that happened 100 years ago, and sort of like the lessons we can learn from that flu for this pandemic. So here's the first panel of the finished comic. And I'm gonna show you what the script looks like for this panel. So I'm just gonna read this aloud and then I'll show you the script. So it says, in the midst of World War I, a few soldiers at a barracks in St. Louis fell sick with the flu. The commanding officer banned anyone from leaving or visiting the barracks. Here's what the script looks like for that panel. So in the scripts that I write, I always break out what the image is and then what the text is. And I say what page it is and what panel it is. So in this case, it's panel one. You got your label, October 1, 1918. And then the narration here. And as you can see, there's a little number one after that narration because there's a citation there. So when I write a script, it's always like footnoted with the sources so that we can go back and fact check it and make sure it's accurate before it's published. Here's the second and third panel. But a congressman in the midst of his reelection campaign visited the soldiers anyway. It's Jacob Meeker. Soldier coughs. Within a week, 800 soldiers were hospitalized with the flu. The congressman was dead. So in this case, we didn't have any photos of this funeral itself. But you know, I wanted to tell this story of like this congressman visiting these barracks. So first thing I did after writing the script that you see here is try and find reference photos for that. So I got a photo of the barracks I could find, and then I couldn't find any photos of like that congressman's campaign or his funeral. So I looked for other photos from the time that we could use elements of. So this is like a different campaign, from the same time. So I'm like, oh, okay, so maybe that's what like the font would look like. Probably there'd be an American flag involved. This is what Jacob Meeker looked like. And then another piece of campaign material from that time. So, and then, on the right-hand side here is a clip from a newspaper reporting his death. So these are all elements where I give these to the artist in a big Dropbox folder and say, here's the photo references I have, like make this into something that feels like it evokes that time. So here's what the artist Joyce Rice did with those materials. So as you can see, like we don't have a photo of this. So she had to take those elements and kind of make it into, here's what this might have looked like, while trying to stay true to like the feeling of the time and her own creative vision for this. I'm not gonna read this whole thing, but you can just see, here's what the script looks like for the next few panels. And as you can see, there's photo references stuck in there. And it's very clear like what's narration. So then here's some photo references I got for these panels. When I saw these, photos online, I was just like, wow, we have to include these in there. These signs are something that you could see again today. So I really wanted to get these images in there. I also found, there are photos of like a public service announcement from the time on the left, and then on the right, there's a French newspaper talking about the flu, and those like dancing skeletons are so wild. Whenever I find something that's like a really strong visual like that, I'm like, oh, we should use that. So I give all these to the artist and say, you know, here's the materials we have, make whatever choices you want about how to portray them here in the panel. And this was probably the most iconic photo of that time of these nurses with the American Red Cross loading victims of the flu into their wagon to take them away. So all of these photo references became this section of four panels, this grid in the comic. So as you can see, the artist used all those images I just showed you, but interpreted them in her own way. She edited some things out to make them more clear. And she combined a couple photo references together to create a scene. So like in the first panel, we saw those two different posters in two different places. But in this panel, she's putting them together. I think that's an okay editorial choice because it's like from the same time, they're speaking to the same issue. We want people to understand that like, here's what the posters were at the time. You also see a couple other editorial choices here. So here's that photo, here's the panel that's like based on that photo of the nurses loading the flu victims into their like ambulance. It looks, there's a lot of things that are pretty accurate here. For example, like the car kind of looks like the car from the time. Their uniforms look pretty much like the uniforms in the photo, but there's definitely some editorial changes here. So here's what the actual photo looked like. As you can see, there's like cars in the background. There's other nurses in the image. She made some choices while translating and adapting these photo references into the final version. Here's what all the, here's what a bunch of the different photos look like again, next to the final grid. So the point I'm trying to make here is that as an artist, you're always making these editorial choices about how to adapt like pieces of our history, pieces of our present into the story that you're telling as an artist. This is the kind of process that any journalist does with the material that they have, but with comics, it feels like a really specific process because you are drawing what you're seeing and kind of making those visual choices. Okay, I'll talk a little bit more about Guantanamo Voices now and tell you about how the choices I made in that book. So like I said, one of the first things I did was go visit Guantanamo. And I took as many photos as possible. So Guantanamo is a military base in Cuba. And so I went there and I knew that I wanted to take photos of pretty much everything I could to give the artists a lot of reference material. So here's, for example, a photo of my ticket on the plane down there. So if I wanted to have a panel where I told an artist, be like, hey, draw my ticket, I have a photo reference for that. Lots of like detail shots so the artist can like accurately draw the ferry. This is the ferry going there, for example. This is Camp X-Ray, which is part of the prison that's fallen out of use and it's now like overgrown and feels really wild. So I got some photos of that so that the artist could accurately draw that portion. And then some of these, they're not great photos. It's okay. It's more just showing that feel in the place. And getting all those details that are necessary for the artist to draw somebody. Because there's a lot of military uniforms. I took a lot of detailed shots of the military uniforms of the guys who were showing us around on this tour. Also, I wanted to get some like feel of the base and the base around the prison into the story. So whenever I saw things that were interesting details or elements of life on base, I definitely took photos of those and knowing that later on I'm going to be writing a script where I say, hey, draw this. There's a McDonald's on base. And there's also like, this is the coffee in the dining hall there. I thought these names of these coffee brands were really funny. So I was like, wow, this is, even like the coffee is patriotic. So those kinds of details are things I'm always keeping an eye out for as a comics artist, knowing that those details are what helps like make the comic feel real. When I was there in Guantanamo, the base was hosting an escape room for like all the people that worked on base. That's the kind of thing that I definitely couldn't make up. These are some detail shots from the prison itself. You're not allowed to talk to anybody who's imprisoned at Guantanamo. So they showed us around like an empty part of the prison. Because you're not allowed to talk to anybody there, I tried to like get as much humanity as possible into the comic through like the other elements there. So for example, I took photos of like the books they're reading and wanted to include that in the comic. Also at Guantanamo, there's a gift shop. Like if you've ever been to a military base, it's just like any other military base where they have like a gift shop where you can buy stuff that's branded with the name of the base. So they have like Disney paraphernalia, a Minions shirt, and like they sell these postcards from there as well. And these postcards are what inspired the cover of the book. I wanted it to look like a postcard that's sold in the gift shop. But then when you look a little bit closer, you see these scenes of violence. And to me, this just really kind of hits home at the way that the government has sold Guantanamo as this place that's like safe and legal and it's a beautiful sunset. And then when you look a little bit closer, you see these scenes of violence and horror. So altogether, it creates a surreal and disturbing picture that hopefully draws you into the book. And for this, just like with other comics that I work on, I wrote a script and then I gave that script to each of the artists to work from. So each artist had their own chapter that was based on an interview with a different person. So chapter one was me going to Guantanamo and kind of the experience of talking to the PR people there. So this I gave to the artist Hazel Nulevant, and these are Hazel's thumbnail sketches. So first Hazel did these thumbnails, and then this more refined version that's the called the pencils, even though it's all digital. And then from there did the inks and the colors. And then Hazel referenced the color palette that I sent, and then did the final version. So here's what the final version looks like. Here's another page that I like where you can see that kind of use of the color palette and it's shifting there. And as you can see here, you can really clearly see who's speaking. So we've got a label with the date, the place, and then I'm talking, and then Chris is talking. It's another character. One cool thing I did with this book was I asked an artist, Casimir Lee, to develop this color palette that then I gave to each of the 10 artists in the book. I call this a sunset tones color palette that I wanted to have be inspired by the like the look and the feel and the tone of the land around the prison. And because this book is 10 different artists, I wanted to have something that felt cohesive throughout all their styles. So I decided that should be the colors. So each artist used this color palette in their own way to draw the story. So this, for example, is a chapter that's drawn by the artist Omar Khoury. And Omar has like a really distinctive style, very like strong textural line work. It almost looks like a woodblock print or a stamp. And he used just like the oranges and blues from this color palette. And then other artists use it differently. So this is Gerardo Alba, drew a chapter about Mark Fallon. And you can see he used the colors here to sort of distinguish different elements. So the very first panel here is Mark speaking in the present. And then he's talking about something that happened in the past. And so you can see the colors shift and help mark the time change from I'm speaking in the present to now this is the story that I'm telling you about the past. That's one way that Gerardo uses colors really well to give you a signal about who was speaking and when. Here's another example, a page from Gerardo Alba where you can see the perspective shifts here. We're close up, we're close up, we're close up, and then we pull away. And it really feels like it gives a lot of emotion and expansiveness to this page. This is another art by Tracy Chawan. This is another chapter about the attorney Alka Pradhan. And you can see she uses this color palette in a totally different way. And it looks beautiful with her style. I love her art. And I think that the colors here make her art really pop. You know, she's like really thick line work makes it pop. That's basically the end of my presentation. If you ever want to say hi, feel free to drop me a line. We're going to get started on the writing and drawing portion of this. So if you haven't already, go and grab your things to draw with and kind of like settle into that thinking mind space. Here's all the ways to get in touch with me. If you send me a letter, I love snail mail, I'll send you a patch or a sticker in return. And I just want to let you know that everyone's welcome to go get a free comics journalism zine that I did based on this presentation. It's at this URL, and I'll drop that in the chat in just a second. But that's the place you can go and download a free zine about this work. Okay, let me see how we're doing in the chat. Okay, now we're gonna get into the portion where we're actually gonna write and draw a little bit for about the next 20 minutes. Sound good? So, okay. What we're gonna do is adapt a moment from your weekend into a very short 4-panel comic. I'm gonna give you a prompt for each panel, but if you wanna do something totally different, you're totally welcome to. You can just like draw one giant thing. You can do a 6-panel comic. You can do a wordless comic. You can do whatever you want, but here's the prompts I'm gonna give you. So grab your pen, grab your paper. And I am the timekeeper. So for the first prompt, I want you to think about a moment from this past weekend where you felt an emotion strongly. So it can be happy or sad or angry, anytime that you felt something really strongly. And for the next 5 minutes, we're just going to do a free write where you write about that moment, and you can get specific about the senses. Like, what did you hear? What did you smell? What did you touch? What did you taste? So this is just writing text. Don't have to draw anything, but I'm going to get started and start writing. Ready? About a strong emotion. Maybe you had a strong emotion reaction to this presentation. Sorry, it's upsetting. Okay, ready, set, go. Okay, we've got 1 more minute. 1 minute. Okay, and pencils down. Okay, that was 5 minutes. Okay, so what we're going to do is use that free write that you just did as the basis for drawing a 4-panel comic. And you can draw right now, I would say draw four panels. You can do them on an iPad or whatever, or you can just do them on a piece of paper. Easiest way to do four panels on a piece of paper is to literally just fold a piece of paper into four panels. You got your four panels right there, or you can draw, if you want them a little smaller, draw a box in the middle of the paper and then follow the folded lines so that it looks like a window. So that's a simple, easy way to do four panels. And I'm gonna give you a prompt for each panel. So I'm gonna share my screen again. And this is the drawing portion of the evening. So I'm gonna turn on some music as we do this and we'll just kind of hang out and draw through these prompts. And if you have any questions or comments you wanna share, feel free to drop them in the chat or unmute yourself and say them as we get started on these prompts. But yeah, here's the freezing you can do. And here's the prompts for each page. Okay, so the prompt for panel one is to draw yourself and show what you were doing in the moment that you wrote about. So if you had a strong feeling while you were washing the dishes, draw yourself washing the dishes and maybe write a sentence about it, but you don't have to write anything. So panel one, draw yourself and show what you're doing in that moment. I'm gonna set a timer for 5 minutes and turn on some music. Does that sound good? Let's see. Can you guys hear that? No, it's just me.
But it looks like a jam.
It's good. Maybe I have to unplug my headphones.
Here we go.
Okay.
You keep on taking from me. I'm a psycho. You're
One more minute on this panel. I'm going to show you panel two just in case you want to get started on that one already. Okay, so panel two. Draw a close-up perspective on something. It could be your hands or a coffee cup. Just get close. And name the emotion that you felt. Stay on time, get started on that second panel.
She likes my face. Don't kiss them boys. I find a way. I'll make a ploy. I need that figure, yeah. She need this toy. Comes all the way from Illinois.
All right, it's time for panel three. If you're up for it, start working on panel three. I'll read it aloud here. So draw a different perspective. Maybe you from far away, or you talking to someone, and explain a little bit about why you felt that emotion. So really try and think of a different perspective you can do here.
Sarah, I actually have a question. That's the right time to ask, but I'm a student at the University of Oregon, and I really want to pursue like comics after, but I just like don't know if it's the most economically viable for me. So I was wondering, like, how did you like keep up drawing and like keep up your passion for comics? And also find those like paid opportunities too.
Yeah, that's a really great question. I would say most people that do comics are freelancers, which means that they just work like from job to job. Someone hires them to do a specific thing, like draw an illustration for a magazine, or to draw an entire book, or to write an entire book. That's called a freelance gig, where it's not like a salaried job where you get healthcare and like a paycheck for the entire year, but you get a paycheck for the project. And so pretty much everybody I know who does comics does it on that freelance basis. That's how I do comics as well, when I'm getting paid for them. And so if you're doing that freelance life, it's like really up and down with how much money you make, which is why it makes a lot of sense to have some kind of job where you have a steady income. So pretty much everybody I know who writes or draws comics also has some other job. Sometimes it's related, sometimes it's not, where they get like a regular paycheck so that they don't have to rely on that freelance comics income. So for me, I have a job where I work at the Center for Investigative Reporting as a digital producer. That's like my regular job. And then I work as a freelance editor for the NIB. And I also make comics that I pitch other places, like pitching a book. And then I also have a Patreon. So Patreon is a website where, that's our time on panel three. So start on panel four. I put the prompt up on the screen. Hopefully you can see it. Where people can basically pay you to support your work if you're like making published because I care about it and I want to. And so that's like how my income looks right now. And that's how I think a lot of comics artists' income looks, where they have something that's like some kind of regular job and then do comics on the side. And I would also say that like I make comics because I love making comics. Like it's not a great
You keep freezing.
About like, oh, this will sell, or like, this will make money. Like, I'm not thinking about marketability at all. I'm just thinking about like, here's what I want to make, and I put it out in the world. And like, every once in a while, someone pays me to do that. But mostly, I just make it for my own fun. Does that feel, do you feel like I answered a money question, or do you have other money questions?
I think you froze a couple of times, but you pretty much answered all of it. Thank you.
Sorry about freezing.
No worries.
But I am super happy to talk about money if anybody wants to. So if you have any other money questions, feel free to ask. Okay,
I'm Sarah, gonna start. I have a question.
Oh, go for it.
I had a question. Yeah, I had a question as well. Thank you first for doing this workshop, but I was wondering how you got into editing after you started making comics.
Yeah, that's a great question. So that person just asked how I got into editing while making comics. Actually, I started off editing a series that I created on my own. So like maybe 8 years ago, I came up with the idea for doing a series called Oregon History Comics. That would be a series of comics about Oregon history, just like it sounds. And so I did a bunch of research and edited and wrote and edited that series, and then had 10 different artists draw comics for it. And that's one where I played the role of both writing it and then editing it. So editing my own scripts, kind of like making editorial decisions about what the artists could do and what we wanted to make, and then publishing that series with a nonprofit called Know Your City. So that was my first job editing comics. And then I worked for the Portland Mercury, which is a newspaper here in Portland, and then also for a magazine called Bitch, that's about feminist response to pop culture. And at both of those places, I would find comics artists who I thought were doing cool things and ask them to like work on a comic together for the publication. So I would edit those. So I would write it, or somebody else would write it. I would edit it. We publish it at those publications. So that's how I got started. And then for the NIB, I started working on like comics that other people would pitch, and then I would work as the editor on them. So somebody else would write them. They would get assigned to me to like get through the publication process. Does that make sense? Let me know if you have any more questions about that. But basically, yeah, just starting off with like my own projects and my friends' projects that I would work on. And then once you have like stuff that you can show people of like, I've done this, this, and this, that's super helpful for getting someone to publish you or to pay you to do the same thing, basically. If you can say, I've already done this comic, I've done this comic, I'm gonna do a similar comic and have you pay me for it, that's super helpful, rather than just going in without anything you've already published to show them. Okay, cool.
If you don't mind, there's one more question in the chat. A couple more. I want to honor your time. I know we've already.
Oh, that's okay. The one from Janice.
There was one before asking a money question about having to monetize commissions for the first time. How do you keep organized, especially when it comes to your rates?
Oh, and I closed out before everyone got to see what the last panel was. I'm sorry. But yeah, it's something else entirely, as somebody said in the chat. So draw something that you haven't drawn before. So not yourself, no perspective you've already drawn, and have like a closing little thought there. Okay, I do have a money question. This is Ash. How do you, having to monetize for the first time to make ends meet, how do you keep organized, especially when it comes to rates? I have a really different approach to rates than a lot of artists do because it's not my main job, so I don't like have to make money from comics to like pay my rent. So I decide my rates basically based on what the person can pay and how difficult the job is. How long is it going to take me? So for example, if it's like a nonprofit, like anarchist collective that doesn't have any money, but is like doing some kind of like mutual aid project that's good for the community, and they want a poster, and I think it will take me like 1 hour to do, I won't charge them anything. I'll be like, I'll just do it for free. If it's like a good cause and I care about it and it's a community thing. But if it's like a company and it's something that's gonna take me like 30 hours, my first question is always, what's your budget? So I ask them how much money they have. That's the biggest question to ask, I think, is just write them back and be like, what's your budget for this? And if they say it's $2,000 and that sounds good to me, I'm like, sweet. Yes, my rate is $2,000. If they're like, we have $100, I'll say, oh, I need at least this much. And it just depends on, like, honestly, like, how long it's going to take me, how much work I think it's going to be. Like, is it fun or is it, like, terrible? And then, and how much money I think the organization has. So, like, for example, I did a comic this year, for last year, for Patagonia, the sportswear company. Obviously, they have a lot of money, but I asked them, what's your budget for this? And it was $2,000. So I said, cool, I'll take $2,000. But I did another comic for, like, a local nonprofit group that was, like, actually more time, but I said, what's your budget? And they had $400. And so I said, cool, $400 is fine because you're, like, a scrappy community group. Okay, cool. And then Janice asked, how do you decide when and how to compensate interviews, especially for smaller projects? And do you, like, so basically, do you pay people for interviews? The big journalistic thing is to say you'd never pay people for interviews. I don't pay people for interviews when it's, like, their job to talk to me or when nobody who I'm talking to is being paid. So, like, for Guantanamo Voices, I didn't compensate anyone for their time talking to me for doing interviews. But for other projects I've done, like, I wrote a different book about relationships, and I talked to some people for, like, a couple hours about relationships they were in, and those were just, like, regular people. Like, they weren't PR people, they weren't, like, legal professionals whose, like, job involved talking to media. They were just, like, regular people who were spending their time with me. And so I was like, I can pay you, like, $50 as an honorarium for your time talking to me. I think that's okay. I think every journalist would have, like, a different place where they fall on that. But I always try to find the balance between, like compensating someone for their time talking to me when it's absolutely not their job to, and there's, like, they don't get anything out of it, versus when it's somebody's job to talk to you, or when they're, like telling you a story that's, like political or, like, about something happening in public. I think I would not compensate them. So for me, it's kind of like, it's kind of gray area. It's a wishy-washy thing that I feel like you have to think about on a case-by-case basis. But definitely, if I'm not paying one person, I don't pay anybody. So it's like a, yeah. You don't want to pay some people and not others, for sure. Okay, let's show what we made. Does anybody want to share what they made? If you do, just, like, raise your hand or unmute yourself and say.
Yeah, I can spotlight you if that's all right with you.
I think Valentina raised her hand. Maybe Natalia raised her hand.
Okay.
I can go first if okay, cool. Should I just show the panels?
Yeah.
Okay, so here's like the notes I took during the class. And then I have a separate piece of paper, but I decided I wanted to keep it all on one page. So I just improvised some boxes by tracing a matchbook that was within reaching distance. So I drew myself in a garden center. I'm pushing a shopping cart. I was at like a big box store, and I had gone there to get soil. And of course I stopped to look at the plants that were available. And I saw this type of cyclamen, which is just like a small plant that people grow outdoors. And I got really excited when I saw it because almost a week previously, I remembered that I had seen this type of plant in a dream, but in the dream, the plant had flowers with two different colors. And I didn't think that a plant like that existed because I hadn't, like, seen two different color ones. At least I didn't remember it. So I got very excited. And then my third panel is me telling my husband, oh my gosh, this plant exists and I didn't know it existed in this variation. And in the dream, I had seen myself, or I had been holding the plant and looking at it in the sun in my mother's backyard. So for my fourth panel, I explained that I bought two of the plants, and one is going to live at my house and one's going to live at my mom's house, since she her yard was in the dream. Okay, thanks.
That was lovely. And also, I just saw Ash put their comic in the chat and I downloaded it and it's cool to look at. Thanks so much for sharing, Valentina. Cool matchbox trick. I like that. Okay, does anybody else want to go? Feel free to raise your hand or just unmute yourself.
Like Julieta?
Hi, yeah. So thank you so much, Sarah, for your time and thank you for this workshop. These are kind of the notes that I took on sort of how I was feeling this weekend. And this is the, this is the comic that I made just quickly. Been sort of dealing with a friendship or two that have kind of been unwinding due to the pandemic and distance. So I was kind of walking and alone, which is rare because I have an adorable 6-month-old and was expecting to feel elated. And then I just sort of like kept literally running into giant, ugly, dirty snow piles. And it just changed my mood and with the space to think about things and process them, I ended up just sort of confronted with those thoughts and feelings from those friendships that are strained because of the pandemic. So just, it's a very, you know, very sketchy and very rough, but I was really stimulated to think about that and to have those prompts. I really love to have the specific things to think about for each panel and perspective. So thank you so much.
I love that perspective in that last panel. I like that cool view on the street. Makes it feel really empty and sad.
Yeah. I'm usually a really happy person, but this situation makes me really sad. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much for sharing, Julieta. I want to make sure that we honor Sarah's time and everyone else's time. I, for one, learned so much. I'm so grateful, Sarah, for your time. And thank you all for being here. We have lots of workshops happening throughout the week. They're all free and open to the public. So feel free to join us for other ones. I just popped the link in the chat. And just huge gratitude to Sarah Mirk. Again, please consider going to her website and purchasing this absolutely incredible piece of nonfiction comics that tell the story of incredible story of this terrifying place. So
yeah, and if you guys have any other questions, I'm happy to answer any questions about anything, anytime. I love questions. So feel free to send me a tweet or an email or a letter. And I'll just show you how mine came out and then we can go. So here's my little comic. I'm packing up boxes, moving houses and feeling nostalgic about leaving behind the apartment where I've been spending the whole pandemic, literally 23 hours a day, 7 days a week. I'm leaving and feeling kind of nostalgic about leaving my little cocoon. So it's nice. Thanks for sharing this time with me and say hi anytime online you want to. Bye.
Y'all have a great rest of your evening.